Okay, so I'm going to talk about information and Fisher's information matrix and then Kolmogorov's test. And the Kolmogorov test, I think, is particularly interesting. The Fisher matrix is important. Well, both are important. Okay, so let's just talk about the Fisher matrix first. So, like any good matrix, it has two subscripts, depends upon some parameters, and it's the mean value, or the estimated value of, and it's a product of two things. It's the logarithmic derivative of the probability distribution with respect to a particular parameter theta. The theta could be the mean, the variance, or some other parameter. And it's a particularly symmetrical matrix because this is theta L. So it's that mean value. And of course, what that means is it's partial log P of A, I'm just going to write X comma theta, partial theta K, partial log of the probability distribution, partial theta L times the probability distribution. And now we're integrating over dnx because this is the probability distribution to get x1 on the first try, x2 on the second try, x3 on the third, up to xn. Okay. All right, now, there are certain obvious features, namely, I just wrote something down that's wrong. I meant to write 1, I wrote 0. One, of course, is the integral of p of x and theta dnx. This is just the normalization of the probability distribution. And most people would have thought, well, we're not going to do anything with that. But Fisher realized that that was actually a very meaningful expression because, in particular, you could differentiate it, and then you get 0. Is the derivative of p of x and theta with respect to, say, theta k. And he then took one step further and said, well, let's take the derivative of the log of the probability distribution with respect to theta k. And now we have to multiply by p of x and theta and do dnx. And so now you see this is now a probability, this is a mean value statement. This is the mean value of this partial derivative vanishes. This partial derivative is called the score. I don't know why. But this says that the mean value of the score, of all the scores, is 0. Okay, now it turns out you can differentiate again and get another result. And let me use this notation. P comma k is going to be partial p, partial theta k. Okay. And log p comma k is going to be partial log p, partial theta k. Okay. So now let's differentiate this expression with respect now to theta L. And so what we get is we have, we're differentiating this expression. Or equivalently, we're differentiating this expression, say, with respect to theta L. So in the first case, we differentiate this P with respect to theta L. And then we get log P comma k, that's this term, and now we're differentiating that with respect to theta l, and what we can do is divide and multiply by p, and that turns into log p comma l d of x and theta p and x. So the equation is 0 equals that. We've differentiated here, but now we have to differentiate here again, and that is plus integral log p, and now comma kl p of x and theta p and x. Okay, so we've got we've differentiated twice, and we have this expression. This is also often written this way: fkl, which is the Fisher matrix, bang. And that's this term is equal to minus that term, which is log p differentiated with respect to k and l times p dmx. So that's an expression for the Fisher matrix in terms of second derivatives of the log of the probability distribution with respect to two of the parameters. Okay. And we can write that as minus the expected value of log p differentiated with respect to kl. And if you want me to rewrite that, it's the expected value of the second partial of the log of p, partial theta k, partial theta l. That's what that is. So that's an expression for the Fisher matrix. Now, Cramer and Rao use this to form a lower bound on the covariance of any two estimators. And the covariance, let me remind you, the covariance of any two quantities is the integral p of, say, x and y, x minus x bar, y minus y bar, dx dy. So if we just have a problem, we just have two values, two variables, x and y, as opposed to x1, x2, up to xn, then the covariance of x and y is that. So that's an example of covariance. The covariance that Cramer and Rao looked at was a somewhat different covariance. It's a covariance of the kth score and the lth estimator. Okay, so what's that? So that'll be an integral of course, the probability distribution, so I'll write it here, x and theta, where this is n values of x and several values of theta. And now the score, the kth score, is partial log p, partial theta k, which I could have written more in a more abbreviated way. And then this estimator, we're going to put in there, since this is a covariance matrix, notice the mean value of the kth score, like the mean value of any score, is zero, so we don't need to subtract its mean value the way we would if we were doing the covariance matrix. But as we have the this estimator, we have to subtract theta L, and we have to subtract the bias, and that's our expression. Okay, so that's dnx. So that's the thing that Cramer and Rao focused on. Now, are there any questions here?
Very theoretical.
What?
Very theoretical.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's, frankly, that's, that wasn't a question, but you get a candy anyway. I agree with you.
What?
I find it very theoretical, and I have a very high tolerance to theory. But I completely agree. At some point, one's neurons go numb with this stuff. I hope that won't happen now. Okay, now we can simplify this a little bit. It's integral of p of x theta, or let me just write p since it'll be useful to make a code. Then this is log p, comma k, that's that term. But now this is a constant. Theta L is a constant, BL is a constant, and so when we do the integral over x with p, we're just getting a constant times the kth score, but the mean value of the kth score is zero, so we can drop that. So this is u sub L dn x. So this is the thing that Cramer-Rao focused on. And now if we look at this again, we see, oh, this is, wait a second now, I need to straighten something out here. Yeah, this of course, if we rewrite it a little bit more carefully, the law, the kth derivative of the log of p, of course, is 1 over p comma k, in other words, the derivative of the probability distribution, times ul dnx. The p's, of course, cancel, and so this, let me go up here, this is just an integral of p of x and theta. Let me rewrite this. It's the derivative of p of x and theta with respect to theta k, that's this term, times u sub l dn x. And now, if we think about it, that's just the kth derivative of the mean value of the lth estimator. So this is e of u sub l partial theta k, or in this abbreviated notation where comma k means derivative with respect to theta k, we just have mean value of u sub l comma k. All right, so that's the thing that Cramer-Rao focused on. All right, the next step is to do some linear algebra, which will get us to this famous Cramer-Rao inequality. And the way I think of it is the following. We introduce some constants, yk and wl. These are arbitrary constants. And we're going to write p as square root of p times square root of p. This, because p is positive, there's no ambiguity here. And we're going to take this equation here, namely CKL equal to the kth derivative of UL, and we're going to do the following. We're going to do sum on K and L, YK, the kth derivative with respect to theta, or with respect to the derivative with respect to theta K, of U sub L times W sub L. So this is going to be an integral of a sum on k and l up to m, however many thetas we have. And this is going to be yk partial of log p partial theta k, a square root of p, and then UL minus, and we're going to put in theta L and the bias, we're sticking them back in, WL squared P DNX. Okay, so that's the thing that we're looking at. And First of all, and we're gonna look at this in terms of we're gonna write this in matrix form, so that we're gonna have a vector y, which is y1 up to ym, a vector b, which is the bias vector, b1 up to bn. What else? A vector w, which is w1 to wn. A vector u, which is all of these estimators, u1 to um. And of course a vector theta, and I'm using capital theta, which is theta 1 down to theta n. So we've got this. We've got all of these vectors, and people are disappearing here. Well, this is the way it is. I mean, you asked for this discussion. I'm also going to group this matrix partial of u sub l, partial theta k. I'm going to call this grad of u bar KL. So that's a matrix. All right. So what does this equation look like in this matrix notation? Oh, first of all, what is this grad u bar KL? Well, this this is the kth derivative of the mean value of u, of course, is theta of u sub l is theta l plus bl. And bl doesn't involve theta. So this is just, well, it does, actually. This is delta kl from this term. And the next one is the kth derivative of the lth bias, or the bias of the lth estimator. Okay, in this more compact notation, what we have is y transpose grad u bar, that's this matrix, w. We write this as an integral, y transpose grad log p, and that's this thing, square root of p, u transpose minus theta transpose minus b bias transpose. W, these are the arbitrary constants, square root of p, pnx. All right. So that's a mouthful. It certainly is. And if I knew of a simple approach, I'd use it. Okay, we're going to make it worse, though. We're going to square it. So we square it. However, there are all these Schwarz inequalities, and they are our friends. There's a whole gang of Schwarz inequalities. And the one what I'm going to use now, I'll write down up here. The absolute value of some integral, a to b, of rho g bar, complex conjugate of g, dx squared, is less than or equal to integral a b rho f squared dx times integral a b rho g squared x. Okay. So that's the Schwarz inequality. I'm going to apply that to this expression. And that's going to say that this thing here, which is the square of an integral, is less than or equal to the product of two squared integrals. Okay. So I'm going to, but this squared integral is this, and so I'm going to write this like this. Y transpose grad u bar w squared is then less, which is this squared, is less than or equal to, the first term is y transpose grad log p, square root of p squared dnx. So I've taken, I should have written this in colored chalk. That's this term. And so the second one is this term, which is then the estimators minus the their mean value, their thetas, their mean value, well, not their mean values, but their, anyway, the thetas and the bias. Into just dotted into the arbitrary numbers w, and then a square root of the probability squared dnx. Okay, so this is our inequality. And we can make this a little bit simpler, of course, by just and so let me do that here. Let's just pull out the square root of p squared terms, and that will give us something a little bit simpler. So I'll get rid of this square root of p. And then over here, I'll get rid of this square root of p. And put a p there. Okay, so now we've got something a little bit simpler. Now, part of this is actually Fisher's matrix. In other words, in the last line, we've got the first integral, which is this thing here, the gradient of the log of p squared dotted into y. That means we're going to have the partial of the log of p with respect to each of the thetas, theta k, times partial of log of p with respect to theta l. That's the Fisher matrix when multiplied by p and integrated. And so we have the Fisher matrix multiplied by these y's, which are arbitrary. The second one is this covariance of the estimators. That is to say, over here, these are arbitrary constants, and this is the estimators, the covariance of the estimators. Okay. All right. So what does this look like in these abbreviated terms? It's y transpose grad u bar times w squared is less than or equal to y transpose, and now I'm writing it as the Fisher matrix, y, times w transpose covariant matrix, w. Okay. Now there's a trick. These y's and w's are arbitrary, so we're going to set y equal to the inverse of the Fisher matrix times the gradient of the u's times the arbitrary constants w. And this is a matrix. This is a matrix. This is a matrix. This is a vector. So that's a vector. And when we do that, what we have is the following. We have W transpose grad U bar transpose F inverse grad U bar W squared is less than or equal to W transpose grad U bar transpose F inverse grad U bar W, W transpose covariance W. All right, that's a mess, but there's a common factor. And the common factor is actually huge. It's this thing, which occurs twice. And in fact, we see it squared over here. So when we cancel the common factor, what we get is W transpose. Well, I unfortunately, I think it would be better to write the thing the other way. What we get is W transpose grad U bar transpose F inverse grad U bar W is less than or equal to W transpose CW. So that's this term here. And we canceled this from both sides, so we just have one factor of this. Okay. Let me just make sure I've got these inequalities right. Yeah. Okay, that's the Cramer inequality, because if we notice here, we've got W is an arbitrary vector on both sides. And so what this is saying is that no matter what M vector, real M vector you choose, the real M vector being W, W transpose CW is bigger than W transpose this thing, W. And so that's the statement that C is greater than or equal to grad U bar transpose. Grad U bar transpose F inverse grad U bar. And remember, U-bar was defined somewhere over here. Anybody see it? The U's are the estimators. U-bar are the mean values of the estimators. And the grad means you differentiate with respect to the thetas. Okay, so let's just look at that again. Grad U-bar, well, what is that? In fact, we were talking about that here. Grad U-bar is right here. That's the kth derivative of the elf, of the mean value of the elf estimator. So that's delta KL plus a derivative of the bias. Okay. So this is then the identity matrix plus the grad of the bias. So the Cramer-Rao inequality, and it's often written with C on the left, C is greater than or equal to I plus grad B transpose Fisher inverse identity plus grad B. Okay, or in terms of the arbitrary vector W, this is W transpose covariance W is greater than W transpose identity plus grad of bias inverse Fisher, and this is transpose identity plus grad of bias W. Now what we do is we take WJ, the arbitrary vector, being delta JK, where K is some fixed integer. And when we do that, what we get here is this thing is simply CKK, which is the mean value. It's basically the variance of the kth estimator. That's what C was, that covariance matrix. So that says that CKK, which is this, is greater than or equal to, and now this vector just has a kth element in it, so it looks like this. 0, 0, 1 in the kth place, 0, 0, 0, and then this identity matrix, the F inverse, identity plus grad B, and then a vector that's 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, and so forth. Okay, what that gives you on the right-hand side is, first of all, if we forget about the biases, we just get the kth element of grad B, the kth element of the kk element of the Fisher inverse matrix, and so forth. In other words, I'm sorry, I'm not going through that. I'm setting that equal to zero for the moment, and we just get a one here in the k. This is just the Fisher kk inverse. I should just read what I'm writing. Or in other words, say it differently, it's the inverse Fisher matrix, kth element, plus L equals 1 to M, 2 Fisher inverse KL, the Lth derivative of the kth bias, plus Lj equals 1 to M, Fisher inverse Lj, partial L dk, partial J dk. Okay, so that's the Cramer-Rao lower bound on the covariance or the variance of an estimator. So let me just make sure we know what this is. This is uk minus theta k minus bk squared p of x and theta dnx. This thing, which is the variance of this estimator, the difference between the estimator and its mean value, that thing is greater than or equal to this thing here, which involves the Fisher matrix. In particular, if you have an estimator that's unbiased, then the B's vanish. And when the B's vanish, what we have is that the variance of the kth estimator is greater than or equal to the kth element of the inverse Fisher matrix. Okay. So that's the end of the derivation. I'll give you a quick, two quick examples, and then we'll switch to the Russians.
Should I work there?
No, I just came here to get a little bit of water. And I see I'm running out of chalk. Okay. So let's apply this Cramer-Rao lower bound to the Gaussian. So here's our endpoint Gaussian distribution. And only two thetas in this case, mu and sigma. And this is then a product, j equals 1 to the n, of the Gaussian for xj, mu sigma, mean mu variance sigma. And so this is just 1 over sigma root 2 pi to the n, e to the mind of sum on J from 1 to N, xj minus u squared over 2 sigma squared. Okay. To carry this out, we have to do a bunch of Gaussian integrals. I'm sure you can do that. In fact, these days, you can do that faster than I can because you use Mathematica or Python or something. In any event, you can then compute, for example, the mu mu element of the Fisher matrix. This would be the partial of the log of PGN with respect to mu. I don't need to write theta. Theta sub mu, it's just mu, squared times PGN DNX. And if you carry that out, you get N over sigma squared. If you now compute, the Fisher matrix, I forgot to say, is symmetric, obviously. And so F mu sigma is then an integral of the partial log of PG with respect to mu, partial log PG with respect to sigma, PG dnx, and the answer that we get is zero. It's with respect to mu squared.
It's
mu occurs up here. Okay? And the sigma is here. So you have to differentiate. Here you differentiate with respect to mu and sigma. You get this complicated expression. You do the integral either with your fingers or you click. Click and type, and you get zero. And of course, that's also F sigma mu. And now the next one is F sigma sigma. Well, we're running out of blackboard space, so I'm going to back up. F sigma sigma is then an integral of the partial of log P with respect to sigma. Well, squared times P dnx. Notice that the diagonal elements of the Fisher matrix are naturally positive because they're the mean value of something squared. And so the Fisher matrix, I mean, it could be zero, but that's, but they're non-negative, let's put it that way. Okay. Anyway, after you've clicked enough times, with Mathematica, you get N over 2 sigma to the 4. That's a 2. So I'm going to write it again because it's not very clear. Okay, so now we know the Fisher matrix. We also know the inverse Fisher matrix. F inverse is then sigma squared 0, 0, 2 sigma to the 4th. Divided by, let me just get this straight, divided by n. So the inverse Fisher matrix is 1 over n times, so in fact it's actually simple that it's sigma squared over n, 1, 0, 0, 2 sigma squared. That's the Fisher matrix. What do we find from this? What we find is, first of all, that the variance of the estimator of the mean, and this is the one that we know is unbiased, and what we find is, well, we've known what that is, namely, we computed the variance of the ordinary estimator of the mean minus the mean, so that's the covariance, in other words, or the variance of the estimator of the mean. We computed that to be sigma squared over n, and we see that's equal to the inverse, mu mu element of the inverse of the Fisher matrix, sigma squared over n. So that means that the ordinary mean saturates the lower bound. So you can't do better than the mean. But of course, we never had any doubt about what the mean, the estimator of the mean was. On the other hand, if you compute the variance of the estimator that we use for the estimator for the variance, and of course we're using Bessel's correction, what we get when we compute it is 2 over n minus 1 sigma to the 4th. And this is greater than the estimator that we get here, which is 2 sigma to the 4th over n. So the estimator for the variance in the case of the Gaussian has a has itself a variance that obeys the Cramer-Rao inequality but doesn't saturate it. In other words, we don't have an equal sign here the way we did for the other. What that means, I guess, is that there's a better estimator of the variance than the standard estimator. And it would probably be an important result to find that. Anyway, all right, so I leave that to you. Okay, now we go to a totally different, in the book there's another section, maximum likelihood and chi-squared. But what I'm going to do now is skip directly to Kolmogorov, which is a, and you should relax because I'm going to be quoting two theorems but not proving them. And so what we have now is just a couple of, it's just sort of an amazing story with a couple of results. Of course, this is the matrix, so we need another parenthesis there. Okay, so suppose we have n measurements, and we want to know, do these measurements come from some theoretical probability distribution? For example, suppose we were at the LHC and we were measuring, we wanted to know what the mass of the Higgs was. So then we would have various measurements of the mass of the Higgs, and we'd then say, that's sort of trivial, the mass of the Higgs. It's rather, might have a theoretical probability distribution, which I should write as PT of X, say. And we want to know if we get a certain sequence of X values, say 100 or 1,000 or 1,000,000, are they consistent with this theory, that this theoretical probability distribution, so this thing gives us an experimental probability distribution. We want to know, is that consistent with this conceptual probability distribution? And of course, the conceptual probability distribution is one that would come out of some understanding of the physics or the biophysics or the biology or whatever. Okay. So what is our experimental distribution? Well, our experimental distribution, it's a probability distribution which is the sum, j equals 1 to n, of Dirac-Dutton functions. In other words, this is a probability distribution, and you integrate it from minus infinity to plus infinity, you get 1. It's positive, and it has peaks at the values that we actually got. So this is our empirical probability distribution. And obviously, it doesn't look like, normally we don't think of that as a, well, we might. I mean, suppose we knew that the value was either x1 or x2 for sure, then, if it were, say, flipping a coin, we would get plus 1 or minus 1, say. And so it would be the probability distribution for a fair coin would be 1/2 delta of x plus 1 plus 1/2 delta of x minus 1. So this is our empirical probability distribution. And now what we can do is we can form what's called a cumulative empirical probability distribution for the interval minus infinity to the x. And this is just an integral. Mathematicians like to integrate the probability distributions, whereas in physics, we often think of things this way because we often think of the square of the wave function as the probability distribution. Anyway, this is PE of x prime dx prime. And if we do that integral, obviously it's a trivial integral to do. And so what we get is just simply, if we go up to some value of x, we just get j over n, where xj falls in this interval between, in other words, if we integrate up to x, we pass the delta function for x1, x2, x3, and if x is greater than xj, we get the xj one, but if it's less than xj plus 1, we don't get the j plus first. So the answer is we just get j contributions over n. So that's the empirical probability distribution. We've got a half hour left, right?
Yes.
All right. So that's plenty of time. Okay. So then the question is, how can we compare this probability distribution with our theoretical probability distribution? And of course, our theoretical probability distribution is probability. This is the cumulative probability up to x, and this will be minus infinity to x, the theoretical probability distribution dx prime. So that's the definition. Now, what you do is you compute the distance between the two probability distributions. We've got an empirical one that's very simple. It's a staircase. You go to minus infinity, it's 0. You pass the first value, it goes to 1 over n. Then it goes to 2 over n, then 3 over n. And eventually it goes to 1. And then this one does whatever the theory tells it to. And so we define something called d sub n. N, remember, is a number of measurements. D sub n is defined as the supremum, or the least upper bound, which I guess is the lub, on an interval minus infinity x infinity of the absolute value of the empirical probability distribution for n points, cumulative empirical, so in other words, this thing, minus the theoretical cumulative probability distribution up to x. Okay, so that's the basic definition. Supremum means least upper bound. In other words, if these numbers are all less than 3/4, then the least, then d sub n is 0.75. So. But, because 0.75 only, they're all less than 3/4, but some of them get arbitrarily close to 3/4, or even hit 3/4. But none is above 3/4. Now, it's obvious, if you think a little bit, these probability distributions are all normalized, and they're all positive, so they're between 0 and 1. So what we know is the d sub n is greater than or equal to 0, less than or equal to 1. So d sub n, this distance, this is called the Kolmogorov distance, is between 0 and 1. There are simpler differences due to Smirnov. Sounds like a manufacturer of vodka. I don't know if it is or not. But anyway, and he invented two distances. One is the supremum, or the least upper bound on all x of, and here he took something that's, he got rid of the absolute value. So the empirical minus the theoretical. And he also has d minus n, and it's the same supremum, but now he's just inverted the things. He has PR theoretical minus infinity x minus the cumulative experimental or empirical. And a little thought shows that that the Kolmogorov distance is the maximum of d plus and d minus. So the Kolmogorov distance is the maximum, is the greater of the two Smirnov distances. Okay, so what do we expect? What we expect is that as n goes to infinity, the cumulative probability distribution, which is the staircase, the empirical cumulative probability distribution, which is a staircase function, should start to approach the empirical, the actual empirical distribution. And in that case, we'd expect that this Kolmogorov distance should get smaller and smaller. We know it's between 0 and 1. It should get smaller and smaller. Okay. So some people, and let me just quote them here because I'm again running out of space. Glibenko and Cantelli proved that if you're taking samples from, in other words, if your empirical distribution, if these events xj are actually coming from the theoretical probability distribution, then in the limit of n going to infinity, the Kolmogorov distance goes to 0. So what they proved is that, I'm writing it wrong. I'm trying to do two things at once. That basically the limit of the Kolmogorov distance as n goes to infinity is 0. That's what we expect if it's coming from the correct theoretical distribution, and that means that the probability, and so I don't think I should use cumulative, the probability that d infinity is 0 is 1. So in other words, what I said was, in using this sort of ordinary physicist language, was the limit of d sub n should be 0. What these guys proved was the probability of the Kolmogorov distance as n goes to infinity being 0 is 1. All right, that's sort of confusing. The real issue, though, is how quickly does the distance between, in other words, if the points are coming from the theoretical distribution, how quickly does the Kolmogorov distance go to zero? And this is the absolutely remarkable result of Kolmogorov, which is just absolutely amazing. So let me first of all say, all right, here's Kolmogorov's theorem. His theorem is this, that the limit, as the number of experimental points goes to infinity, of the probability that the square root of n times the Kolmogorov distance, dn, and that's this thing over here. I think you probably have it. That's this thing. The probability, and I shouldn't have closed those parentheses, the probability that this is less than any number u is equal to a universal function called k of u, k standing for Kolmogorov, of course. And this is equal to 1 plus 2 times a sum, and the sum is k plus 1 to infinity minus 1 to the k e minus 2 k squared u squared. And the incredible thing is that this is universal and independent of the theoretical probability distribution and independent of the empirical probability distribution.
Basically, you are saying in any experiment this should work?
Yeah, any experiment, any theory, anything, always works. It's universal, absolutely incredible. I don't think I've ever seen a mathematical theorem that is as impressive as this. I mean, it's just, you know, where did this come from? So let me just state it again. We take some data. We compare, we have a theory of what's going on. This theory of what's going on gives us a theoretical probability distribution for the values of something that we're measuring that we call x. We then take some measurements and we ask ourselves, do we know what we're doing? That is to say, are these points coming from the theoretical, from the probability distribution that we computed on the basis of our understanding of the physics or the biophysics or medicine or whatever, okay? And so what we do is we compute the Kolmogorov distance for n points, we multiply by square root of n, and we're thinking here of n as being big, 100, 1,000, a million, a billion, whatever, depending on what one is doing. In physics, we're talking a billion, in medicine, we're talking 5, I don't know, 10, I don't know what we're talking in medicine, but it's certainly a smaller number. And remember, dn is the cumulative probability distribution minus the theoretical absolute value least upper bound. It's some number between 0 and 1. But so what does this tell us? This tells us that if we have the right theoretical probability distribution, then this distance goes to 0 really fast. It goes to 0 like 1 over square root of n or something. And this is this universal function here. Okay, so...
So is k the number of experiments? Is k the number of data? What's k? Is the number of experiments?
K, no. K we sum from 1 to infinity just to define the Kolmogorov function.
Oh.
And it's a function of u, because u is here. And I have a graph, I graphed that. You guys would buy the bloody book and look at figure 13.7, you will see that what the graph looks like. So here is the graph. 1, 0.002. And it's very sigmoidal. It starts out and it's flat as a pancake for a while. And then at about 0.4, it starts to rise in a sort of sigmoidal way. And then it basically flattens out. Well, it doesn't quite flatten. It does something like this. It's more like that. So that by the time you get to 2, you're essentially at 1. That's the Kolmogorov function. And what? This is U. And this is K of U. Oh wait, or is this 1 minus K of U? Where is it? I mean, no, I have K of U. So for U equal to 0, what's the answer? If U is 0, e to the minus, this is e to the 0, which is 1. Well, this is a divergent series, actually. But for small u, you'd have to compute it. Well, I did compute it. You get 0. Suppose we let just u become very large. If u is very large, these terms are all essentially 0, and the answer is obviously 1. Okay. So it's clear that k of infinity is equal to 1. And what's true is that k of 0 is 0, and it goes from 0 to 1 sigmoid. I wrote a program to compute the graph. Okay, so now let's actually see what's going on. And what I did was I used two probability distributions. One is Gauss's, and Gauss's probability distribution looks basically like this. And Gossett's, which is the student distribution, Gossett worked for a brewery in Ireland, actually, as a statistician. And the brewery wouldn't let him publish any, wouldn't let any employee publish anything under their own names. So he published his article under the name Student. And so it's called Student's Distribution. Anyway, there's a whole family of student distributions, and they look like this. The one I picked, so I've got the Gaussian distribution, P of X, mean 0, sigma equal to 1, and then Gossett's, or the student distribution, P of X, mean 3, and sigma equal to 1, and then they have the same variance, and they have the same mean. This is 0. 3 is the parameter in the student distribution. So the student distribution is more peak in this case. So the question was, could the Kolmogorov test whether I was using, if I was trying to fake the Gaussian using the student, would Kolmogorov's test be able to tell? The answer is yes, and pretty impressively. And so let me try to finish this in 10 minutes. What did I do? I took I computed the cumulative probability distribution from from the Gaussian, and from the Gaussian, what you get is minus infinity x turns out to be 1/2 the error function of x over root 2 plus 1. So this is just a standard result that you can work out. And I generated points, and I computed, what I did was I generated, I set n equal to 10 to the m, and set m equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. And what I found was the square root, so I computed this thing. The square root of 10 to the m, d sub 10 to the m. So I actually measured what d was. I took points from, well, actually, I could compute it this way, so I didn't have to do anything really. So I just computed this, and what I got was 0.69, da da da, 1.07 second. And I'm just, this is for 1, and this is for 6, say. And they're all less than 2, as expected. I don't know if I said that to you, but I may have, in fact, said it wrong. But because these are both, I don't know, that can only be, that has to be less than 1. Anyway, they're less than 2. 2 is the limit here, because they're from the theoretical distribution. Anyway, then I took the points from Gossett's distribution. And what did I get? Well, now I got 10 to the m, d sub 10 to the m, equal to, and these were very different numbers, 0.77, 1.4, 1.45, blah, 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 27.6, 87.8. So this is 6, 5, 1, 2, and I'll be about 3, 4. So you see these numbers here, the probability that this is less than u, and the point is it has to be less than 2 is 100. That's why I said 2. The answer here, then, what this is saying, then, is that if you take, well, what did I get? I got 87, but yet the probability that it's less than 2 is 100% is 1, because this thing goes to 1. So clearly, the points from the student distribution are not coming from the correct Gaussian distribution, and even though the mean and the variance are the same, Kolmogorov smelled a rat. Yeah.
So here with the
we're computing this thing.
Right. So
and Kolmogorov's huge theorem is that the probability that this is less than u is given by k of u. And so the probability that it's less than 2 is essentially 100%.
So here, this one's getting bigger.
Right, so it's bigger than 2.
But the other one is, the other one is less than 2, okay.
Yeah, this was, all right, let me give you these numbers again. 0.69. 0.7, 1, well, when I say 1, 2, this is 10, 100, 1,000. These are all 10 to the m points. So it's 0.69, 0.7, 1.2, 0.73, 1.2, 1.07. I know it's not.
So what does that mean? Why the numbers don't go?
Well, they're not monotonic. There's no necessity that they're monotonic. The necessity is that they've got to be less than 2. Mm-hmm. And I do them, then I draw the points not from the Gaussian. These are all random, right? I do draw them, and as you go out here, you're multiplying the distance by square root of 10 to the m. Okay? So it's not that the distance got bigger, it's rather that the multiplier got bigger by a factor of 10, a square root of 10, 3.
And Where do you write D from? Oh.
D is, D, alright, let's swing over here. The theoretical is for the Gaussian. And you have an exact formula, it's a Gaussian. You fire up Mathematica and you do the integral. Okay. Over here, what I had was I took them from the student distribution. And I probably could have done it analytically. I think what I did, well, I don't remember whether I did it analytically or whether I just generated the points from the student distribution and computed this thing on computer, of course. And then I computed what the least upper bound of this thing was for all x. And and these are the cumulative distributions. So these are integrals of the empirical and the theoretical.
So basically, if we have some specific data that we don't know the exact theory behind it, is it possible that we compare them with different distributions and see which one is closer to?
Yeah, you can do that. What you can do, in other words, the procedure I would say would be this. You have your data, okay. And then you imagine various explanations of the data, various theories. And then for each of these theories, you construct a probability distribution. And once you have a probability distribution, you then compute the cumulative probability distributions. And then you compute the Kolmogorov distances as you increase the number of points. Or you just take the maximum number of points you have. And you take that maximum number of points, you take the square root, you find the Kolmogorov distance, and if that's less than 2, you're okay. You think that you probably can have some confidence in that explanation. If it's greater than 2, you got to throw that explanation out. And, you know, n has to be big enough for things to make sense. Because you see here, this is 10 points, 100 points. This is less than 2, so you don't know. Let me see what the next one. The next one was 3.3. And then it was 9. And then it was 2787. So once you went to 1,000 points, you could tell gossip from Gaussian. But if you only used 100 points, you couldn't. And now, when you know, I ask about the medical situation here. You know, in other words, you need like 1,000 points in order to 1,000 measurements in order to tell one from the other. And this Gaussian, this students and Gaussian with the same mean and the same variance. They look pretty different when you graph them. And yet you need 1,000 points to tell them apart. I mean, we probably could have gotten away with maybe 200 or 300. Okay, well, there's a little more in the book, because what you can do is you can carry this further and compute the these various, well, let's see. What did I do there? Now I can't remember. I was reading through this afternoon. What I did was I computed the empirical probability distributions. Let's see. Well, I might as well just read this. I generated L equals 1, 2, up to 100 sets of n equals 10 to the nth points for m equals 2, 3, 4, and so forth, drawn from the Gaussian and the student distribution, and used them to form 100 empirical cumulative probabilities from the Gaussian and from the students. And then I computed the distances, Gauss-Gauss, student-Gauss. And then I plotted those distances, and I plotted square root of 10 to the m, the distance, and square root of 10 to the m, the other distance. And what happens is that the thing actually follows the actual Kolmogorov distribution. In other words, here I can say it here. So the cumulative probability that it's less than u, the distance is less than u, plotted against u here, for the Gaussian, compared to the Gaussian, we have something that goes up to 1 by 2. And so this is both k and the probability distribution, empirical, Gaussian. And on the other hand, if we do gossip, what I got was something here for 100 points, something here for 1,000 points, and for 10 to the fourth points, it was so far off scale that I couldn't put it in the graph. And this, in other words, these are the cumulative probability distributions that the distance is less than u, which is the Kolmogorov. In other words, I was actually computing this. Yeah, turn it. I was actually computing this. And so by computing that, it was amazing how well this Gauss-Gauss followed Kolmogorov, and the other ones were just way off. Okay, I guess, any more questions? No. All right, so why don't you push the red button on this spot?